James 2, 1-7. Our topic, respect of persons, or no partiality is allowable. Respect of persons. Let me read James 2, 1-7. My brethren, have not the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, with respect of persons. For if there come unto your assembly a man with a gold ring and goodly apparel, and there come in also a poor man in vile raiment, and ye have respect to him that weareth the gay clothing, and say unto him, sit thou here in a good place, and say to the poor, stand thou there, or sit here under my footstool, are ye not then partial in yourselves, and are become judges of evil thoughts? Hearken, my beloved brethren, hath not God chosen the poor of this world rich in faith, and heirs of the kingdom, which he hath promised to them that love him? But ye have despised the poor. Do not rich men oppress you and draw you before the judgment seats? Do they not blaspheme that worthy name by which ye are called? Thus endeth the reading of God's holy word. With James chapter 2, we enter a new section of the epistle. This section, of course, is strongly connected to the previous section, in that the apostle now turns to the discussion of one of the major themes he has introduced, that of wealth, charity, and the treatment of the needy in the church. This discussion expands upon the previous statement of 1:9-11 as well as 1:22-27, and it forms the basis for the strong denunciations of chapter 4 and 5. Chapter 2 can be naturally divided into two parts. There is 2:1-13, which in the beginning starts with an illustration, and then moves to a prophetic rebuke with applicatory teaching. There will then be a discussion based on the Old Testament precedent in 2:14-16. The first part of the chapter teaches us to honor the Christian poor and to not show partiality. While the second part discusses the need to share with them and show Christian love. This teaching was necessary because it had apparently become quite common in the Christian community to violate the biblical law with regard to the Christian poor. James learned of this sinful behavior and now proceeds to deal with it firmly and prophetically in the spirit of the prophets with rebuke. And there are a number of important things to note in this section. First, James begins with the central proposition or teaching for this whole section. Verse 1. My brethren, have not the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, with respect to persons. The expression, my brethren, which we see repeatedly in the epistle, is often used by James to introduce a new topic. It makes it clear that the imperative applies to all Christians. The sentence begins with a present active imperative, hold not, which has the sense of stop holding, or do not have the habit of holding some Christians with less esteem. Do not regard others in the church as less important. If we paraphrase the sentence, which is a bit confusing in the King James Version, it reads, let not respective persons be a characteristic of the manner in which you maintain faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, the statement about the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ means the object of our faith and is equivalent to saying, do not have respective persons, which contradicts your profession of Christ or adherence to Christianity. In other words, respecting of the persons in the church is totally contradictory to the teaching of biblical Christianity. He does not mean the personal faith of Christ, but our profession of the Christian religion. The faith of Christ here is the faith, means really the faith in Christ, for it's what is called in Greek grammar an objective genitive. This is like Galatians 2:12. I live by the faith of the Son of God, meaning Paul lives by his faith in Christ. His faith in Jesus Christ affects every aspect of his life. Also note Philippians 3:9. the righteousness which is through the faith of Christ, meaning the imputed righteousness which is received through faith in Christ. Now, before we focus our emphasis on this negative imperative, we must see how clearly James focuses our attention on faith in our Lord Jesus Christ as the essence of the true Christian religion. In writing this epistle, the apostle focuses mostly on practical matters of sanctification. The pure and undefiled religious service both to God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. But in this verse, he testifies to the centrality and divinity of Christ to real religion, true religion. Jesus is the Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory. This is how he's identified. The expression Lord of glory is used of God the Father in Ephesians 1:17. This refers to the Shekinah glory of God. In Hebrews 9:5, we read about the cherubim of glory. Jesus is the Lord of glory in all the grand generality of this expression, as God the Son, the second person of the Trinity, who is equal with the Father in every way, and he has an essential, infinite glory. So the Bible, once again, teaches that Jesus is God in no uncertain terms. It's very clear. As a divine human or theanthropic mediator, he has achieved a perfect redemption, and who has achieved a perfect redemption, all power in heaven and on earth has been given unto him. And he has sat down, he has ascended into heaven, and has sat down at the right hand of the majesty in the heavens. He has been given a name above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven, of things in earth, and things under the earth. One cannot be saved from sin and guilt without believing that Jesus possesses this glory, both as God in his intrinsic being and as the mediator. There is nothing more important for you than believing in Christ as God, as mediator, and as the perfect Savior of men. In this verse, especially taken in connection with the precious statement of truth in 1:18 about the new birth, tells us plainly that God's testimony concerning his Son is the spring from which sanctifying, reviving springs flow forth through the whole man. Before the new birth, all Christians were dead in sins, just like everyone else. But of his own will, God originated spiritual life in them. And this through the word of truth regarding Jesus received by faith. To be a Christian, one must have faith in Christ. One must believe in him as he is revealed in the sacred scriptures. Not your definition of Christ, not the world's definition of Christ, not the Roman Catholic definition of Christ, the biblical definition of Christ alone. Paul says, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved." Paul counted all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus his Lord. He counted all things as dung that he might win Christ and be found in him. And you must do the same. Not having his own righteousness, which was of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, which means, of course, faith in Christ. The righteousness which is of God by faith. That's from Philippians. The reason that we have noted the focus on Christ as the foundation of Christianity in James is because a number of communions, Roman Catholic, Eastern Orthodox, and of course other heretical groups such as the Federal Vision, appeal to the book of James, especially chapter 2, as a basis for their teaching that good works or law keeping, keeping the law, contributes in some way to one's salvation. Well, James makes it perfectly clear before he gets into a section about faith without works is dead. He makes it perfectly clear that such thinking is diametrically opposed to biblical Christianity. The center, the axis of true Christianity is Jesus Christ and faith in him. James' whole point of focusing our attention on faith in Christ is to tell us that faith in Christ and being a respecter of persons are diametrically opposed to each other. To be a respecter of persons in the church is inconsistent with one's profession of Christianity. The context in which James sets forth this negative imperative is designed to show us the gross inconsistency and absurdity of professing Christ and yet being a respecter of persons. Such things cannot be combined. They're like oil and water. They don't mix. Faith in Christ means that we look solely to Christ for salvation because we have no merit or any claim before God of goodness or law-keeping that merits eternal life. Nothing in my hand I bring, only to thy cross I cling. We have nothing of our own that merits eternal life. We have nothing of our own that contributes to our salvation. We have nothing of our own that even acts as something that grasps salvation. It's solely by faith, which is a gift of God, and the faith that grasps Christ is purely instrumental. It is non-meritorious. We're saved by faith or through faith, not because of faith. We are saved solely by grace through faith, which is a gift of God. We contribute nothing to our redemption because even our best works are filthy rags in God's sight, as Paul mentioned earlier, and as we read in Luke 17:10, when you've done everything you were required to do, say, we are thy unworthy servants. We have done what was our duty to do. The Bible teaches explicitly that even our best works are tainted with sin and marred by sin and are non-meritorious. We come to God as naked beggars in the dust. If we look at mankind from a moral perspective, all men are sinners, full of guilt and worthy of death, worthy of damnation, worthy of the lake of fire. All men, everyone, whether rich or poor, powerful or slave, is in the same position before God. It is only because of God's grace and mercy in Christ that some are saved. God's electing grace. In Christ, men come together in a perfect equality spiritually because Jesus achieved a perfect redemption and we have accomplished nothing ourselves. We have nothing to brag about because salvation by grace through faith alone eliminates all bragging rights. The only boasting we can make is boasting of Christ and what he's achieved because we haven't achieved it. He did it. Christ did it. Salvation is a gift of God. With all this in mind, the idea of inequalities in the church where some are treated better than others because of sex or wealth or class is completely absurd and irrational. That is not to say that there may be different responsibilities in the church. That is not to say that there may be authoritative offices in the church, but we do not treat others as lesser, as second-class Christians, because we're all saved by Jesus Christ. And this teaching is fully in accord with the moral law of God. In Leviticus 19:15, we read, "Thou shalt not respect the person of the poor, nor honor the mighty, but in righteousness thou shalt judge thy neighbor." There's no distinction. Deuteronomy 1:17, "Thou shalt not be respect of persons in judgment, but shall hear the small as well as the great." These verses refer specifically to different treatment by courts, whether civil or ecclesiastical. What James, of course, is teaching is far more broad. He's talking about interpersonal relationships in the church and not simply what takes place in the courts. What James is condemning is showing favoritism, in this context, a favoritism toward the rich in their public worship services. The position of where one is seated, for example. And it applies to the courts, it applies to Christian fellowship. In the things of God, all in the church are positionally equal in God's sight, because all are in Christ. All are in Christ. We shall have a common salvation, Jude says in Jude 3, a like precious salvation, 2 Peter 1:1. In James 1:8-9, the apostle gives comfort to the poor, the despised brethren in society. In 1 Corinthians 10, 1-19, Paul goes into a fairly lengthy discussion of not regarding the brethren in their love feasts, not favoring some over others. The wealthy believers were feasting sumptuously and were drinking to excess, while the poor brethren had nothing to eat at all. And that's wrong. It's scandalous. Paul called it despising the church of God. That is, despising the people who are of the church. There is a tendency of the among people in this world to look up to the rich. They often receive favoritism in civil courts, and at times are even favored in ecclesiastical courts. In the papal church, there was a habitual tendency to exalt the rich. In our culture, the poor are exalted by our tax system and the government benefits, even when they are wicked and undeserving. And that's totally wrong too. That's a regarding of the poor. We must never make external things such as money or power the ground of our respect and affection. We are not to esteem what the world esteems, such as riches or outward advantage. The Pharisees looked for Christ to come with outward pomp and glory, a mighty king, a mighty warrior, a wealthy man. But he came as a lowly, humble, relatively poor man who had nowhere to lay his head. We do not deny that one can esteem certain things, but our affections must be according to the measures and proportions of grace. David's delights were directed to the saints and the excellent of the earth, Psalm 16:3. Paul said, "We bestow the most honor on the uncomely parts," in 1 Corinthians. Those who have the least of worldly pomp and wealth, if they excel in Christ, should have the most of Christian respect and honor. Not simply some worldly thing like having riches. But what do you do for Christ? How are you living for Christ? Are you excelling for Christ? That deserves some respect. When David describes a godly man in Psalm 15:4, he says, "In whose aisles a vile person is condemned, but he honoreth them that feareth the Lord." That is his priority in life. Not how much money do you have, not how much power you have, not your position in life, but does he love God? Is he serving Christ? Is he faithful? Now, it's perfectly lawful to show honor and respect to those God has placed in positions of honor, such as civil magistrates and elders. It is also lawful to have a high regard for godly believers. But respect and honor is given not because of some intrinsic greatness on their part, but because of the position and bounty that God has bestowed upon them. God has placed them in that position by providence and by grace. Here's what Robert Johnston writes, and it's very good. Quote, "I need hardly say that nothing in the apostles' precepts is intended to forbid the fullest recognition in ordinary life of the distinctions of society. It can never be wrong. Indeed, the whole point of Scripture and many express injunctions call upon us to give to those whom God in his providence has placed in positions of authority or of greater prominence and influence than ourselves the customary marks of respect, not in any spirit of mean subservience, but in the spirit of freemen, the Lord's freemen. The principle stated by our apostle here is that in matters where Christians have to act simply and distinctly as professors of Christianity, members of Christ's church, not as citizens or members of general society, they are not to allow worldly considerations of any kind to sway them." End of quote. So he's not teaching communism or the idea that there can be no places of authority. He's not saying that at all. In addition, one must not treat Christians differently in courts, in public worship, or situations of church fellowship. That point is crystal clear in the context. Christians who treat other Christians poorly in fellowship are acting totally contrary to the gospel. In professing the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, we should not show respect to men so as to cloud or lessen the glory of our glorious Lord. No matter how professing Christians may think of such behavior, it is certainly a heinous sin in the sight of God. We are to be no respecter of persons in the church of God. Now, by way of application, we see that the church is a true brotherhood of love due to the salvation of Jesus Christ. Left-wing politicians, socialists, communists, speak much of compassion and community. But without Christ, who really changes our hearts, They bring only a pretended community based on tyranny and force. You're going to help the poor, whether they deserve it or not, and we're going to steal your money through unlawful taxation. We're going to give it away to others so they'll vote for us. That's the way of the world. The revolutionaries of France, who took power from the king and the aristocracy in the late 1700s, spoke of a new age of liberty, equality, and fraternity. But they hated Christ, and they hated biblical Christianity, and they believed salvation could only be achieved through human reason. They thought that paradise and a new society of total liberty and justice and freedom and happiness could be achieved solely through autonomous human reason. And the result was a bloody, barbaric reign of terror where thousands of innocent people met the guillotine. It was a period of arbitrary, unmerciful tyranny where sin, murder, theft, and fornication reigned in the land. When men seek utopia through the arm of the flesh, they only bring a curse upon the land and misery. The communists who took power in the Soviet Union, China, Cuba, and Vietnam were even worse, putting millions of people to death and enslaving many thousands, multiple thousands, slave labor camps, and ushering in slavery and poverty to the people, all in the name of love and community. A state cannot cause different classes to love each other by propaganda, by lies, and raw coercion. It can't be done. It must come from the heart through regeneration, the regeneration of the Holy Spirit sent through Christ. In fact, the lies and propaganda of the left have led to greater hatred and division in our nation. Only Christ and the gospel can bring true community, because sinful, unregenerate men hate God and have a natural hatred towards other men. Respect of persons due to worldly, unimportant, vain considerations are a normal aspect of the way our sinful world is. That's just the way it is. But all of this foolishness is swept away by the redemptive work of Jesus Christ. In verses 2 through 4, James illustrates his teaching by an example. The case noted is given as a hypothetical situation which probably reflects actual situations that either James witnessed in his ministerial labors or may have been reported to him by others. For if you come into your assembly, if comes into your assembly a man with a gold ring and goodly apparel, and there come in also a poor man in vile raiment, and you have respect to him that weareth the gay clothing, and say unto him, sit thou here in a good place, and say to the poor, stand thou there, or sit here under my footstool, are ye not then partial in yourselves, and are become judges of evil thoughts? These verses, by the way, are all one sentence in Greek. The word assembly is synagogein, which is the word for synagogue. Some interpreters therefore see this as a meeting of public worship, where the rich are given the best seats up front, and the poor are told to stand in the back or sit in a bad or worse place where they are inconspicuous. Others think that James is describing the meeting of the elders and congregation as a kind of ecclesiastical court. The elders are investigating disputes among members of the church, some being rich and others being poor. According to this view, favoritism is shown to the rich during the dispute, even to the level of where the disputants are seated. That's one view. This view is based largely on the use of the word judges in verse 4. In addition, we know that the Jewish synagogue held trials and pronounced judgment during congregational assemblies. That's a fact. In the New Testament, we find allusions to something very similar. The view that this is a court is popular, yet has little support. The word judges can be taken generically or refer to judgment in general, not an official court. When people favor the rich over the poor in public worship or situations of fellowship, they indeed are rendering judgment in favor of the rich over the poor. Therefore, I think it is likely that James is referring to an ordinary meeting of Christians for worship and not to a court case. There's simply not enough evidence in the text to assert that this is an official court. The arrangement of Christian worship services were almost identical to that of a Jewish synagogue. In the Jewish synagogues of the first century, the more prominent members, or those who were equivalent to elders and deacons, would sit up in the front. This practice, at least of elders, is still maintained among the old-fashioned, strict Dutch Reformed churches. If you go to a big old Dutch Reformed church, and it's a real strict old-fashioned one, you'll look in the front row and you'll see all the elders and their families sitting there, and the elders are wearing white shirts and black ties. This practice, at least of elders, is still maintained by many. The elders and their families sit in the front rows, not in order to exalt the elders, but because the elders are expected to pay extra close attention to the sermon and analyze it biblically. According to some scholars, the Jewish practice had become perverted where the front seats were even elevated a little above the rest of the floor and were called the chief seats. They were reserved for prominent scribes and for Pharisees. So with this background in mind, now keep in mind that James is writing to a predominantly Jewish Christian audience who would be familiar with the Jewish practices of that day, we have here a picture of an ordinary assembly of a Christian congregation for public worship. The service is about to start, and the seats are fairly full. The door in the back opens. Two men walk in almost simultaneously. One man is obviously very wealthy. His garments are made of very fine, expensive, beautiful cloth. He has an expensive gold jewelry on. The word translated gay, as in gay apparel, by the way, refers to something so beautiful that people look upon it with admiration and special reverence. People in power deliberately dressed to impress. In the ancient world and throughout most of history, people would dress according to their class or station in life. The rich man in Luke 16:19, we are told, was clothed in purple and fine linen, purple being the most expensive cloth, way above what most ordinary people could afford in the ancient world because the dye was extremely expensive. When the wealthy father wanted to honor the prodigal son at his return, he called for the best robe and a ring to put on his finger. So keep that in mind. He is clearly a man of wealth and taste. The other man is clearly poor. He is dressed in old, tattered cloth. The expression vile raiment is used, which means dirty and worn out to the extreme. James is describing a Christian in dire poverty, someone very, very poor. He is extremely poor. The word raiment is the same word in the Septuagint in Zechariah 3:3-4, where mention is made of the high priest, these filthy garments. So we have a man in tatters coming in, obviously extremely poor, but a true Christian. He cannot afford shoes, and he is barefoot. An office bearer in charge of seating people as they come in, likely a deacon, arises to seat each man. The rich man is escorted to the front and is seated in one of the best seats left available. The man who is poor is told that he can stand in the back and watch, or he can sit on the floor at the feet of the deacon. If this was a secular meeting or a traditional, not a biblical Jewish synagogue, the seating arrangement is exactly what one would expect because they make a distinction between the rich and the poor in the public worship service. They do. And this is what James condemns. This is totally unacceptable to James because it contradicts the gospel and the lordship of Jesus Christ the Messiah. This whole scenario leads up to a rhetorical question designed to elicit a biblical response and conviction. Are you not partial in yourselves? The basic idea in this context is this. By your treatment of these two men, one rich, one poor, have you not revealed that your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, is very weak, deficient, and inconsistent? Are you not explicitly contradicting the very principles that you profess to believe? Did you not, by your special treatment of the rich man and the poor treatment of the poor man, who are both Christians, reveal a lack of faith in Jesus Christ and his gospel? Are you not acting worldly, as if Christ's kingdom was a part of this evil world? Very strong language, very strong treatment. The fact that Jesus is the Christ, the Lord over all, and the Lord of glory should teach us to respect all Christians, whether rich or poor, because they are Christians. One's relationship to Christ and conformity to his teachings is far more important than foolish, worldly considerations. If you believe the gospel, then you believe that the poor partakes equally with the rich in justification, in salvation, in the broad sense, sanctification, adoption, glorification, Both are clothed with the perfect rich robes of Christ's righteousness. Both have their sins forgiven. Both have a seat at the wedding feast of the Lamb. There's no distinction. With this in mind, it is unbiblical and it is irrational to treat them as anything less in the kingdom of God. We know that ultimately all men, except of course Christians who are alive at the second coming of Christ, we're told in Thessalonians, all men will die and their bodies will be that they pampered in their life will rot and will turn to dust. All of their riches and possessions will be turned over to others. Outward, worldly advantages do not serve men at all at death. They do you no good at all. Oh yes, you can be buried in a nicer casket and have a nicer tomb, but you're dead. You don't know what's going on once you're dead. So what is really important is whether one believes in Jesus Christ as he is revealed in the sacred scriptures and possesses life eternal. Christians who show extra respect for the rich are acting totally inconsistent with Christian doctrine. In professing the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, we must not show respect to men. We must not allow worldly considerations to affect our thinking or lessen our commitment to the truth of the gospel. Think, for example, of Paul and his relationship to Onesimus. Onesimus was a mere slave, but when he was converted to Christ, Paul regarded him not as a mere slave, but as a brother in Christ. Philemon 16. Thus, the messengers of the churches are called the glory of Christ. 2 Corinthians 8:23. Christ is ashamed of none, but those who refuse to confess him, but those who are ashamed of him. Well, we have some applications here. There's some obvious applications of these verses, which we've considered to a degree. Let's look at them again. Number one, we must learn not to view men as the world views men. The things that are important to God and the kingdom of Christ are different than what the unconverted honor. Our society is obsessed with riches, with fame, with worldly power. But Christ wants faith and obedience to his word. He exalts the humble, and he blesses those who walk in godliness before him. True wisdom places Christ in his kingdom first. It does not exalt possessions and worldly honors. And then number two, we must never be partial in the household of God. We must begin with a proper biblical outlook of our brothers in Christ. All of them are loved. All of them are precious in the sight of God. God is not a respecter of persons, and we must learn to love and respect all, whether rich or poor, whether ugly or beautiful, whether white or black. None of that matters in the Church of Christ. We're all spiritually the same in God's sight, clothed with the righteousness of Christ. Let us view men through the eye of faith and the biblical world and life view, not through our pagan culture. All undue honoring of worldly greatness and riches should especially be watched against in the Christian community. In biblical Christianity, rich and poor stand on the same level. Both are saved by grace in the same way. The only distinction in regards on the day of judgment at the judgment seat of Christ is based not on riches or poverty, but obedience to the word of God. The rewards of grace are based on how you loved and served Christ. The important question is not how rich am I and how many possessions have I gathered up, but rather what am I doing for Jesus Christ and his kingdom? That is what lasts. Store up your riches in heaven where moth and rust cannot destroy, where thieves cannot break and steal. Store up your riches there. For what you have on earth, you're going to die. You're going to leave it behind. And then in verse 5, James gives an additional argument against the respecting of persons or showing partiality. Hearken, my beloved brethren, hath not God chosen the poor of this world rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom, which he hath promised to them that love him? Now this emphasis on the poor, which we find in Scripture, is often misunderstood and abused by those who like socialism and statism. James is not saying that there is something virtuous, meritorious, or intrinsically good about being poor. Poor in wealth. Poverty is not some precondition of salvation, just as being rich is not intrinsically evil or immoral. Abraham became a rich man. David was a rich man. Solomon was a rich man. Many godly men were rich. James' point is that God hath chosen the poor. By a special design, God has decided to focus on the poor and has chosen many of the poor to be heirs of eternal life. Jesus pointed to this fact, to the fact that he came to preach to the poor. This was a fulfillment of prophecy that proved he was God's commissioned and anointed servant. God of his own good pleasure chose the poor and focused his grace on the poor. Paul says of Christians in his day, not many wise, not many mighty. The first choice that God made in the world was of poor men. Such were not only poor in spirit, but were poor financially. Jesus chose fishermen to preach the gospel, and his early followers were mostly composed of the poor in society. Few of high rank became Christians, not because the poor have special insight, but because of God's grace. God's electing grace. He has chosen the poor of this world. The poor have something far more important than money, beautiful clothes, gold jewelry, and great mansions. James says they are rich in faith. So it's not their being poor that makes them good. It's their faith that is something worthy to be emulated. This faith is what grasps Jesus Christ and his precious salvation. It possesses what is far more important than all the riches on planet Earth, than all the riches one could own, a world of gold. When we lay hold of Christ by faith, we not only have all the guilt of our sin removed forever by Jesus' blood, but we are given eternal life. We have a mansion waiting for us in heaven. We have a new heavens and a new earth waiting for us. We can behold the face of God in perfect love and fellowship with him. Through God's electing grace, the poor of this world become rich in faith. The treasures received by faith are not only far more important than earthly treasures, but they are permanent. Earthly treasures are not permanent, as we've noted. They can never be taken away, the treasures of grace. They are not lost by death or fire, earthquake, or tornadoes, or by thieves. The gift of faith gives us spiritual wealth even now. And that all the gifts of the Spirit, peace, wisdom, holiness, are possessed in this life. Paul says that if we are children, then we are heirs. Heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. We are heirs of the kingdom. Paul in Ephesians says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ accordingly. And here's election again, as he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. No, you didn't earn anything. God chose you in grace. Christ saved you by his precious blood, and he imputed his righteousness to you as a gift. Now, James adds that he has promised the kingdom to them that love him. This love is produced by the Spirit in regeneration. If God has chosen the poor and saved them through Jesus Christ and made them heirs of the kingdom, then on what basis are you treating them with partiality? God certainly does not, and neither should you. Now, after proving his case both theologically and logically, James turns to a strong rebuke and a final practical reason in verses 6 and 7. But you have despised the poor. Do not rich men oppress you and draw you before the judgment seats? Do they not blaspheme that worthy name by which you are called? You see, when there's known guilt, when there's sin being practiced in the church and it's not repented of, it is soundly rebuked by an apostle or an elder. When the practice is a serious sin and there's no repentance, a strong rebuke is necessary. We see this in the case of Nathan with David. James equates their partiality with a despising of the poor. He says, this is your sin. You are actually despising your poor brothers in Christ. How dare you? You must repent of this sin at once. We can learn much from James about the confrontation of scandalous sin. He does not simply rebuke it, but also gives solid biblical reasons for his rebuke. It is a serious sin against God that contradicts the redemption achieved by Jesus Christ. In Proverbs 17:5, we read, whoso reproaches the poor despiseth his maker. Amos in Amos 5:11 rebukes the wicked Jews, saying, you have trodden the poor underfoot. to despise those who God, whom God has chosen and saved and made heirs of eternal salvation, is wickedness that must be prophetically confronted. And then James ends with a final argument from what was occurring in his own day. He notes that rich pagans and rich unconverted Jews are using persecutors, are usually persecutors or oppressors of the church. In Acts 13:50, we read, the chief men of the city were stirred up against Paul and Barnabas. In Proverbs 22:7, Solomon says, the rich ruleth over the poor, and the borrower is servant to the lender. Pagans with money and power are not kind to Christians. The point here is that if being rich was intrinsically virtuous and deserved your praise and treating them better, then why are so many rich people wicked persecutors of Christ's church? Obviously, riches doesn't equate with godliness. One must judge people on the basis, not on the basis of wealth or power, but on faith and godliness. Let us learn from this excellent, crucial section of Scripture not to be partial in the church, to not follow the standards of this world. Let us love, honor, and help the Christian poor, and never, never hold them in contempt. Let us pray. Father, we give you thanks for this amazing section of Scripture. Lord, help us not to be partial. Help us not to imitate our pagan culture, which exalts the rich over the poor, and sometimes exalts the poor over the rich for no good reason, the wicked poor. Help us, Lord, to live consistently with our faith in Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who possesses the glory of the Father. We thank you for him. We thank you for what he's done for us. But Lord, we're sinners. We need your help. We need you to fill us with your Holy Spirit and bend our hearts. Illuminate our minds to understand your precious word and then bend our hearts to obey it, Lord. For we are sinners. Cause us to love this truth. Cause us to understand it and cause us to obey it, Lord, by the power of your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.